Hello and welcome to the Kraaft Shaak. It's Heather here with another This and That Thursday video for you. And today we are focusing on the product Dina Wakley paints. And I know it's kind of funny, I got a mailbox right in front of me. But we're going to paint on a mailbox. That's what we're going to do with Dina Wakley heavy body paints. So I've never painted on a mailbox before, and it's metal. And it's a painted surface, and I probably should have gessoed it, but you know, heavy body paints are pretty good, and I'm working in a lot of layers, so I think it's going to be okay. And I'm also going to be covering and coating this with several coats of Krylon clear spray. So what I have taken is the colors Umber and Night, and put them down on my palette there, and using a sea sponge, I am just basically putting in the shape of a mountain, and that's my base layer. And then I went ahead and grabbed some sky color and a little bit of blackberry, I think is the name of that color. It's a purple. And I'm now going around the mountain shape with that, so that way I can lay in what will be the sky. And the reason why I didn't start with the sky, normally if I were painting on a canvas, I would have just started with the sky and brought it down as far as I wanted to, and then just gone ahead and added in the mountain and everything over the top of it. However, not a canvas. That's my point. This is not a canvas. So I wanted to make sure that I didn't have too many layers of paint that weren't necessary, I guess. And I knew that I could kind of give it that wispy, kind of hazy outline by doing what I did. So that's what you saw. And now I'm just trying to add some texture and some shape. And I also, you just saw me add there down at the bottom, a closer mountain range that is like a hill, basically. So I'm just going to let you know that this is a pretty personal to my hometown. Well, it's not really my hometown, but it is where I live. It is my home is where I live. Butte, Montana. And Butte, Montana is kind of special. Well, I'm sure everybody feels like everywhere they live is, or where they're from is special. But for me, Butte is special in a lot of ways, and one of them is the mountain that divides the city from the eastern part of Montana is called the Continental Divide. And up on top of that, we call it the East Ridge because it's the east and it's a ridge of the Continental Divide. But up on that East Ridge is a 90-foot tall statue known as the Lady of the Rockies. And she overlooks our entire city. And she just celebrated this week 30 years of watching over this city. And there's a huge story about that. I encourage you to Google it and see what you can find out about Our Lady of the Rockies and here in Butte, Montana. But this was kind of my, whenever we come to visit, when I, you know, I'm not from here, but my husband is, and whenever we would come to visit, when you saw that glowing lady up on the hill, because she's painted in NASA white, the same stuff they use on the space shuttle, that's what they use to paint her, and she's lit up every night by donations, and she glows. I mean, it can be the most wintry, horrible night ever, and she is a light, a beacon up on the hill. So it's kind of a neat thing. And there's a lot of inspiration and stories that people have mentioned about her and things, but really, I just wanted to give the impression of her up on the hill. Anybody who's here will know exactly what that means. And so I didn't want to draw her in per se, but at some point in this video, you'll see me attempt to. But I wanted this to be like a wintry scene, and of course that means snow here in Montana, so I added snow, and this whole process of this video, it took me about an hour to make this this happen. It was about an hour and 10 minutes with drying and everything, but I really didn't want you to sit through a lot of that. So I had sped this up 4 times fast, which means it looks like I'm some sort of ninja painter, which you know I'm not, but it really wasn't about technique so much as it was about the use of this paint and that it is pretty versatile. So here we are, just layering upon layer of heavy body paint, and it's all from Dina Wakely's product line. And that little cutout that I got there is a silhouette cutout that a friend of mine had done for me. So thank you very much, Kathy Gillette. You are an amazing, amazing friend for getting me those. And now I'm putting one of them to use. I've put several of them to use, which you may have never seen, but one of them is going here on this. So I really wanted to show you can do some cool stuff with your mailbox. So every time you see me using color and white, it is all heavy body acrylic paint. The only time that I don't use Dina Wakely's heavy body acrylic paint is when I am using the black gesso to put the numbers on, but you'll see. So now the key to this is I had used for that mountainous background there the sponge with three, I think I had three different colors plus white, and they were sky, magenta, and then that blackberry purple. And the sky and blackberry purple are great. Those are great colors. Magenta is a beautiful color. However, it is incredibly highly pigmented, and you can't really cover it up very easily. So you see me doing a lot of white, and then I come back in and do a lot more white. And the reason for that is because that pink just keeps coming back. That magenta just keeps coming back to the front and making it much more gray than I wanted it to be, or much more pink than I wanted it to be. So I do go over this quite a bit with white many, many times. And like I said, the Lady of the Rockies is quite bright. She's a white statue up there, and I want to make sure that she's white, a white statue on my mailbox here. So I'll just keep going over it many, many times. Now, I'm mostly doing this wet on top of wet because I want it to grab in some places. I want it to skip in some places. You see the snow skipping over the top of some of those areas. It's really important because snow doesn't just, cover everything. It lands on the top and then falls down, and sometimes you got an edge of a rock peeking out, or the leg of the head frame. It doesn't cover the whole leg, it just covers part of it, So it was really important that I did that, and I tried really hard to get it like that. And then of course I cut out all the drying time too. I didn't think you wanted to watch me dry it. So okay, so now I'm cutting the numbers, and right about here. Right about here, I kind of realize, uh-oh. I had it intended to leave myself a little bit of these center round parts attached in a way, and I forgot when I started cutting. So I'll fix it on the O and the 9, but on the 0 and the 9. I hate when people do that when they call zeros O's. But anyway, okay, and I just did it. But I thought that I could maybe try and fix it, and then I realized no, I had messed it up. So I'm trying to carefully cut those centers out because I am still going to use them. It's just going to be a little bit more difficult for me. So kind of frustrating. I could have probably taped them back in maybe, but I didn't mess with that. I just decided to do this one correctly. So think about it for a second, and I'm cutting little attachment strips there, and then just going to cut around both sides and leave those attachment strips in the center. And that's easy enough to correct when you go to paint. It's not a big deal, but you needed to do that on the 8 too, Heather. Oh well, you make mistakes, you live and you learn. And you know what? I spent about 15 minutes looking for some numbers, like sticker numbers, and I couldn't find any. And that frustrated the bejesus out of me. So instead of fretting over that, I decided, I'm just going to go ahead and do this. And it was actually, I think, quicker. And I did kind of put those numbers a little too close together, so I am trying to correct it with the knife a little bit, and I think it does okay, because there's a good enough gap there in between them. So now, like I said, this is where I bring out the black gesso from Finnebert's heavy body gesso. So it's got the same consistency that heavy body paint, acrylic paint does. It's just going to be a flat black when it's done. The acrylic paints are much more satin finish, so they have a little bit more of a gloss to them. And this is definitely flat black when it is a matte finish when it is done drying. And I really like the texture that this sponge dauber thing gave it, because it really does kind of seem like they're substantial numbers standing out in the snow. And when I was painting over them, you were able actually to see some of that texture come through. So that part, I really enjoyed it. I really think this turned out much better than I thought it would. Now you can kind of see that, you know, because some of those things moved, that the 8 is not, you know, the right thickness. So I'm fixing that a little bit. And then of course I'm going to fix those little attachment joints there. And yeah, so there, this is pretty much what I ended up with. Now I hadn't originally intended to do this next part, but I kind of felt like maybe I should. So, well, before I say that, this next part is me trying to add some definition to the Lady of the Rockies. So I have kind of mixed a gray by combining some night and some of the other colors. And I probably should have just left it right there, but no. Instead, I decided to maybe try and make a face, and I hated it. I just hated it. She looks dirty. She did, and it looks like a cartoony little, you can't really see it in this video, but I promise you, those little, there's like little tiny eyes that I painted in there. It just looks stupid. Like, she is far away. You should not be able to see those kind of details from far away. So eventually I'm going to go and fix it. However, I needed to let her dry. And that is one thing that's different about these heavy body acrylic paints, is that it takes a while for them to dry because they're very thick paint. And that's a good thing and a bad thing. I mean, it's great when you know that that's the way it is and you don't mind it so much, but it's not if, like right now, I'm trying to spread it on kind of nicely. So I grabbed, you see it just really briefly there, but I grabbed some glazing medium, which is also part of the Dina Wakley Media line, and it thins out the paint for me so that it'll spread so much easier. And that just made all of the difference, because that, the one, when I put the paint on the one, it took quite a while for me to lay down just that straight bit. And then adding the glazing medium, it just made a huge difference in the paint consistency and the flow. So it's flowing right off my brush exactly where I'm putting it and the way that I want it to go. So it's perfect. And it's kind of funny watching this on the video. I can see that the bottom part of the 8 and the top part of the 8 now kind of look like they are separate pieces, which is kind of neat. Now, this is where I was going when I said I didn't originally intend to do this. I wasn't going to put snow on the numbers. It just sort of happened. And I got to say, I love when things happen like that, because it turns out pretty nice, I think. And then having all the snow in the foreground really pushed those mountains back all of a sudden. They are much further back than they were, and I like that. And I decided to add a little bit more snow to the head frame and to really give it much more on the sides, because it was kind of piling up on the horizontal lines, but nothing on the verticals, and needed a lot more snow underneath it though. And what's really neat is that because these paints do stay wet much longer, I was able to clean up a mistake there that happened so quickly. I don't know if you noticed it, but with a baby wipe, just poof, and it didn't take away the layers underneath. But see right there, I just did it again. So just wiping away those layers, that wet white paint, and it's as if it didn't even happen. So now putting in some clouds, because I felt like the sky was just kind of boring. And with all that snow, it had to come from something. So I started painting them in and then used my finger, and that really was the best way to get that wispy cloud puffiness that I wanted. But then I don't really like how white these are, and I'll eventually fix it, but the whole time I'm doing this is just pure white and the glazing medium. And they just look too white. And when snow comes in, it's not white clouds that's bringing it. And again, I tried with the brush to add some of that wispiness to it, but really the fingers just work the best. Yeah, just use your finger already. And I do have to fix that statue. It was kind of driving me nuts. Those grayish lines that I'd put in there weren't what I wanted them to be. And I even tried doing purple, thinking maybe it was because they were gray or whatever, but nah. And then I did add some snow there because I thought there is a section in front of her on the mountain that has a great place for the snow to kind of like shelf there. But I think I overdid it a little bit, and I try to fix it a little bit, and then I realize, you know, you're just going to make one giant white thing, and that's not what we wanted. So I left it alone, and it's good enough. That's what I decided. So again, as I said, I'm adding in some of that grayish purple. It's really more night and blackberry. Just teensy bits of both of those mixed with white and the glazing medium to turn it into that. So there you go. Have a crafty day, everybody. I'm sorry it went over.